to gain an initial foothold in an organization, hackers go through two activities. What are some of the most common issues that people currently encounter? Virtually all companies feel underprepared when it comes to asset inventories. There are three main data sources that most hackers would leverage. Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we look at the best practices in cybersecurity. Today we start on a hacking journey, a three-step hacking journey. The first step, going into an organization, what we call initial intrusion, that's what we're going to focus on today. Followed then by lateral movement, extending privileges within the organization, to then finally cashing out, encrypting data, stealing data, whatever the hacker might have in mind. So initial intrusion today. To gain an initial foothold in an organization, hackers go through two activities iteratively. Discovering assets, trying to exploit those assets. Discovering more assets, trying to exploit those assets, until eventually they hack some asset. In most cases, it doesn't matter whether this is a critical asset. Mostly it won't be. It will be some long forgotten server that just happens to live in your corporate network and that gives the hacker access to your internal network. Not necessarily to internal data yet, that comes later. First, the hacker wants to discover assets that belong to the chosen target company. This can come from a large number of data sources. There are three main data sources that most hackers would leverage initially and that are usually enough to find a vulnerable target. One, registry information. Second, scan results. And thirdly, just Google results. Registry information are available for both domain names and for IP addresses. Today, most companies just register domain names and then use cloud-provided IP addresses. But traditionally, companies accumulated a large number of IP addresses themselves. So for hackers, those can be more interesting because they've often been abandoned, some leftovers after the cloud migration. So hackers do use the company name to search in whose databases for both domains and IP addresses, producing large list of possible targets. Sometimes wrong lists. You can imagine searching for a name, let's say Apple. You find a lot of assets belonging to the company Apple, as well as some Apple farmer somewhere around the world. So there's a little bit of sorting required. But hackers are quite good at automating these processes to a high extent, finding high likelihood assets to try to exploit them. The second data source are scan results. Hackers would scan themselves those data ranges, but they would also leverage available scan results. Shodan, as an example, is a database that is partly publicly accessible. You can also buy a subscription. It gives you quite good intelligence as to what services are running on assets that are likely to belong to your target organization. And then thirdly, Google results. The first Google query that probably most hackers do in discovering assets is company name, subsidiaries. Finding related companies that are just as valid as hacking targets because they often share IT resources. These subsidiary names gained from Google search results give you new search phrases to put into your Whois queries and your Shodan searches. Between all of these search results, you now found the main company and all of its subsidiaries, and for each of those companies, all the Whois entries, as well as Shodan scan results, you run some of your own scanning, and you have a set of, for a large company, thousands of TCP services that you could possibly exploit. Before moving on to the second hacking activity, exploiting vulnerabilities, a quick note on asset inventories. Virtually all companies feel underprepared when it comes to asset inventories. They never have a complete list of their services running in legacy environments and cloud environments, constantly changing. So everybody feels they need to focus additional attention on building a better asset inventory. In my experience, that is not the case. Because really, you want to know the assets that hackers can plausibly find. And by going through those same activities we just outlined, you can build a relatively good asset inventory. Put that together with the CMDBs and other asset sources you already have in your organization, and you're already a step ahead of the hacker. So do not worry about those unknown unknowns, assets that you don't even know you have and you don't know how to protect unless the hacker can find them. So mend the gaps in your asset inventory through Whois searches, Google searches, through Shodan scans, and don't worry about the remaining unknown unknowns because hackers are very unlikely to find those as well. Moving on to finding vulnerabilities. Here we distinguish four classes of issues that hackers are likely to encounter on the internet. One, known vulnerabilities in standard software. Two, configuration issues in standard infrastructure, middleware components, or standard software. 3, credential issues, weak and default passwords on anything that's exposed on the internet. And 4, issues in software that was created for just your company, so issues that exist nowhere else on the internet. Of those 4, the first 3 types of issues can be found with relatively low effort using standard scanners. Even free scanners like Nuclei and Nmap do most of the heavy lifting in enumerating a vast number of possible issues on infrastructure components and web applications, and give the hacker a lot of starting points to try to attack. Only the last kind of issue, programming bugs in your individual application, require a little bit more individual effort. And therefore, hackers are unlikely to try to exploit those first. In fact, they're more likely to just focus on standard issues than to really dig deep into your applications, because they want to have scalable criminal business models, and finding something that only applies to your company is much less valuable than building a tool chain of scanners and known exploits that work against a large number of companies. None of this is to say that you should neglect your custom web applications. They too can encounter standard, easily to find issues by using middleware components, by using standard libraries, or by making configuration mistakes that are common across custom web applications that scanners are also testing for. But do focus your assurance activities on those issues that hackers are likely to find. And those are the ones that can be found through scanners. So many organizations focus on vulnerability assessments in that they do weekly or even daily vulnerability scans, while testing their web applications, their custom code, only periodically around major releases or, let's say, once a year. So between testing your standard components daily and your web application, let's say, once or twice per year, I think that reflects how most hackers would also put the emphasis. What are some of the most common issues that people currently encounter? On top of the list, somewhat ironically, are security appliances, your VPNs, firewalls, and similar appliances. Software issues are found in appliances all the time, and patches are available all the time. However, people don't get around to patch their hardware appliances quite as often as they patch, for instance, Windows. Now, that needs to change, because these appliances are highly exposed to the internet. They run very complex protocol stacks, and they do need patching more than anything else. So make sure that your appliances are all included in your daily or at least weekly scans, and patch as soon as you realize something is found. In fact, patch as soon as a patch is available, even before your scanning vendor knows about any possible issue. The second class of issues often leveraged for initial intrusion are internal protocols unnecessarily exposed to the internet. For instance, SMB, the file sharing protocol between Windows boxes. Once you find SMB on the internet, there's a good chance that you can leverage into an exploit. These protocols do not belong on the internet, and any scanner will tell you so. In today's complex deployments, with some legacy on-premise, some components deployed into different clouds, the line between internal and external becomes a little bit harder to track. So while these issues of exposing internal protocols externally are completely avoidable and very easy to fix with just a single firewall configuration, they keep reappearing. And so you have to keep scanning for them to kind of prune them back before the hackers find them. The third commonly exploited issue are lock-in portals. Portals often for management purposes that usually just show a username password field where you can lock in, let's say, to a firewall configuration, to some management of a web application, any of those portals. They too are somewhat unnecessarily deployed onto the internet because they could be behind the VPN. But in some deployment scenarios, you really want them on the internet, there's no way around them. Exposed lock-in site keep you vulnerable to two possible types of issues. On the one hand, the lock-ins themselves might be weak. Default password, weak password, people can enumerate, try to password brute force. Often there's no restrictions as to how many attempts you get. But then on the other hand, there could be vulnerabilities in the web application itself. And we've seen that especially with firewalls and similar components regularly in the past few years, where you don't need any username password combination. The web app itself can be exploited. But then at the very least, put basic HTTP authentication in front of them. Have a password you have to type in before you actually encounter the username password field. This might feel like a band-aid, and it often is. at least you can't be discovered through standard scanners anymore, because the standard scanner won't know the bespoke password you use for HTTP basic authentication. However weak that password is, however widely shared within your organization, now it requires manual intervention from the hacker and a little bit of extra knowledge to encounter those login portals. So do yourself a favor and hide any username password field that is meant for internal use behind a VPN, or at the very least, behind an additional password. Fourth on the list, missing patches. Of course, everybody knows that missing patches lead to exploitable vulnerabilities, but most are not aware of quite the scope of what all needs to be patched. So, of course, you have your operating system where patch management often starts, Windows, Linux, but there's components below that. You have to patch your firewalls, your other security appliances, even the server itself needs to be patched. The server has management protocols that are available even if your operating system crashes. So your HP, your Dell servers, all of them need to be patched. On top of the operating system, you have your middlewares, often forgotten and often very difficult to patch. Lots of effort required to patch, for instance, an Oracle database. However, those too accumulate issues that at some point become exploitable. Then on top of your middlewares, you have your custom web applications that have bespoke issues, but those custom web applications also include libraries, JavaScript and others, that too have to be under patch management. So patching isn't a singular activity, and in fact, it's not even a singular team that could possibly be responsible for patch management, but rather it's an organization-wide responsibility. We have a separate video diving deep into that. And last on the list, hardening settings. It turns out that most software that you installed, middleware for instance, comes with relatively weak default settings. Makes it easy to deploy, easy to test around a little bit. But once you move from a test deployment into a production deployment, you have to change a bunch of settings to be ready to connect to the internet, basically. We won't go into a lot of details here. There's a separate video on hardening settings. Suffice it to say, the Center for Internet Security, CIS, publishes hardening guides for pretty much any middleware and operating system you'll ever encounter. So just use that as your to-do list when connecting anything to the internet. These are the common technical issues that hackers exploit when getting into your organization, creating that initial foothold from which to do additional lateral movement. Now there's a separate set of non-technical issues that hackers exploit. We won't have time to discuss this today, but there's a separate video in which we go into detail on social engineering and how hackers basically leverage the gullibility and friendliness of people into giving them access that they shouldn't otherwise have. I hope this was interesting, and you'll check out our additional content on patching and hardening, as well as network segregation, basically creating a zero-trust environment, and identity management, avoiding those pesky weak credentials. In the next videos, we're continuing the hacking journey, showing you how lateral movement happens, so how from this initial foothold, hackers leverage their access into higher and higher credentials. And then in the last video of this three-step journey, we'll show you how hackers cash out and what you can still do at this point to prevent major damage. Until next time, happy hacking.